The Underground Railroad by William Still, narrated by Peter Coates. Henry Box Brown arrived by Adams Express. Although the name of Henry Box Brown has been echoed over the land for a number of years, and the simple facts connected with his marvellous escape from slavery in a box, published widely through the medium of anti-slavery papers, nevertheless, it is not unreasonable to suppose that very little is generally known in relation to this case. Briefly, the facts are these, which doubtless have never before been fully published. Brown was a man of invention as well as a hero. In point of interest, however, his case is no more remarkable than many others. Indeed, neither before nor after escaping did he suffer one half of what many others have experienced. He was decidedly an unhappy piece of property in the city of Richmond, Virginia. In the condition of a slave, he felt it would be impossible for him to remain. Full well did he know, however, that it was no holiday task to escape the vigilance of Virginia slave hunters, or the wrath of an enraged master for committing the unpardonable sin of attempting to escape to a land of liberty. So Brown counted well the cost before venturing upon this hazardous undertaking. Ordinary modes of travel, he concluded, might prove disastrous to his hopes. He therefore hit upon a new invention altogether, which was to have himself boxed up and forwarded to Philadelphia direct by express. The size of the box and how it was to be made to fit him most comfortably was of his own ordering. 2 feet 8 inches deep, 2 feet wide, and 3 feet long were the exact dimensions of the box, lined with baize. His resources with regard to food and water consisted of the following: 1 bladder of water and a few small biscuits. His mechanical implement to meet the death struggle for fresh air, all told, was 1 large gimlet. Satisfied that it would be far better to peril his life for freedom in this way than to remain under the galling yoke of slavery, he entered his box, which was safely nailed up and hooped with 5 hickory hoops, and was then addressed to his next friend, James A. Smith, a shoe dealer, to William H. Johnson, Arch Street, Philadelphia, marked "This side up with care." In this condition, he was sent to Adams Express office in a dray, and thence by Overland Express to Philadelphia. It was 26 hours from the time he left Richmond until his arrival in the city of brotherly love. The notice, "This side up," etc., did not avail with the different expressmen, who hesitated not to handle the box in the usual rough manner common to this class of men. For a while, they actually had the box upside down, and had him on his head for miles. A few days before he was expected, certain intimation was conveyed to a member of the Vigilance Committee that a box might be expected by the 3 o'clock morning train from the south, which might contain a man. One of the most serious walks he ever took, and they had not been a few to meet and accompany passengers, he took at 2:30 that morning to the depot. Not once, but for more than a score of times, he fancied the slave would be dead. He anxiously looked while the freight was being unloaded from the cars to see if he could recognize a box that might contain a man. One alone had that appearance, and he confessed it really seemed as if there were the scent of death about it. But on inquiry, he soon learned that it was not the one he was looking after, and he was free to say he experienced a marked sense of relief. That same afternoon, however, he received from Richmond a telegram, which read thus: "Your case of goods is shipped and will arrive tomorrow morning." At this exciting juncture of affairs, Mr. McKim, who had been engineering this important undertaking, deemed it expedient to change the program slightly in one particular, at least to ensure greater safety. Instead of having a number of the committee go again to the depot for the box, which might excite suspicion, it was decided that it would be safest to have the express bring it direct to the anti-slavery office. But all apprehension of danger did not now disappear, for there was no room to suppose that Adams Express office had any sympathy with the abolitionist or the fugitive. Consequently, for Mr. McKim to appear personally at the express office to give directions with reference to the coming of a box from Richmond, which would be directed to Arch Street, And yet not intended for that street, but for the anti-slavery office at 107 North 5th Street, it needed, of course, no great discernment to foresee that a step of this kind was wholly impracticable, and that a more indirect and covert method would have to be adopted. In this dreadful crisis, Mr. McKim, with his usual good judgment and remarkably quick, strategical mind, especially in matters pertaining to the UGRR, hit upon the following plan, namely, to go to his friend E.M. Davis, who was then extensively engaged in mercantile business, and relate the circumstances. Having daily intercourse with said Adams Express office, and being well acquainted with the firm and some of the drivers, Mr. Davis could, as Mr. McKim thought, talk about boxes, freight, etc., from any part of the country without risk. Mr. Davis heard Mr. McKim's plan and instantly approved of it, and was heartily at his service. Dan, an Irishman, one of Adams Express drivers, is just the fellow to go to the depot after the box, said Davis. He drinks a little too much whiskey sometimes, but he will do anything I ask him to do, promptly and obligingly. I'll trust Dan, for I believe he is the very man. The difficulty which Mr. McKim had been so anxious to overcome was thus pretty well settled. It was agreed that Dan should go after the box next morning before daylight and bring it to the anti-slavery office direct, and to make it all the more agreeable for Dan to get up out of his warm bed and go on this errand before day, it was decided that he should have a $5 gold piece for himself. Thus, these preliminaries having been satisfactorily arranged, it only remained for Mr. Davis to see Dan and give him instructions accordingly, etc. Next morning, according to arrangement, the box was at the anti-slavery office in due time. The witnesses present to behold the resurrection were J.M. McKim, Professor C.D. Cleveland, Lewis Thompson, and the writer. Mr. McKim was deeply interested, but having been long identified with the anti-slavery cause as one of its oldest and ablest advocates in the darkest days of slavery and mobs, and always found by the side of the fugitive to counsel and succour, he was on this occasion perfectly composed. Professor Cleveland, however, was greatly moved. His zeal and earnestness in the cause of freedom, especially in rendering aid to passengers, knew no limit. Ordinarily, he could not too often visit these travellers, shake them too warmly by the hand, or impart to them too freely of his substance to aid them on their journey, but now his emotion was overpowering. Mr. Thompson, of the firm of Merrihew and Thompson, about the only printers in the city who for many years dared to print such incendiary documents as anti-slavery papers and pamphlets, one of the truest friends of the slave, was composed and prepared to witness the scene. All was quiet. The door had been safely locked. The proceedings commenced. Mr. McKim rapped quietly on the lid of the box and called out, "All right." Instantly came the answer from within, "All right, sir." The witnesses will never forget that moment. Saw and hatchet quickly had the five hickory hoops cut and the lid off, and the marvellous resurrection of Brown ensued. Rising up in his box, he reached out his hand, saying, "How do you do, gentlemen?" The little assemblage hardly knew what to think or do at the moment. He was about as wet as if he had come up out of the Delaware. Very soon he remarked that, before leaving Richmond, he had selected for his arrival hymn, if he lived, the psalm beginning with the words, "I waited patiently for the Lord, and he heard my prayer." And most touchingly did he sing the psalm, much to his own relief, as well as to the delight of his small audience. He was then christened Henry Box Brown, and soon afterwards was sent to the hospitable residence of James Mott and E.M. Davis on 9th Street, where, it is needless to say, he met a most cordial reception from Mrs. Lucretia Mott and her household. Clothing and creature comforts were furnished in abundance, and delight and joy filled all hearts in that stronghold of philanthropy. As he had been so long doubled up in the box, he needed to promenade considerably in the fresh air, so James Mott put one of his broad-brim hats on his head and tendered him the hospitalities of his yard as well as his house, and while Brown promenaded the yard, flushed with victory, great was the joy of his friends. After his visit at Mr. Mott's, he spent 2 days with the writer and then took his departure for Boston, evidently feeling quite conscious of the wonderful feat he had performed. And at the same time, it may be safely said that those who witnessed this strange resurrection were not only elated at his success, but were made to sympathize more deeply than ever before with the slave. Also, the noble-hearted Smith who boxed him up was made to rejoice over Brown's victory, and was thereby encouraged to render similar service to 2 other young bondmen who appealed to him for deliverance. But unfortunately, in this attempt, the undertaking proved a failure. 2 boxes containing the young men alluded to above, after having been duly expressed and some distance on the road, were, through the agency of the telegraph, betrayed, and the heroic young fugitives were captured in their boxes and dragged back to hopeless bondage. Consequently, through this deplorable failure, Samuel A. Smith was arrested, imprisoned, and was called upon to suffer severely, as may be seen from the subjoined correspondence taken from the New York Tribune soon after his release from the penitentiary. The Deliverer of Box Brown, Meeting of the Colored Citizens of Philadelphia. Correspondence of the New York Tribune. Philadelphia, Saturday, July 5th, 1856. Samuel A. Smith, who boxed up Henry Box Brown in Richmond, Virginia, and forwarded him by Overland Express to Philadelphia, and who was arrested and convicted 8 years ago for boxing up 2 other slaves, also directed to Philadelphia, having served out his imprisonment in the penitentiary, was released on the 18th ultimo, and arrived in this city on the 21st. Though he lost all his property, though he was refused witnesses on his trial, no officer could be found who would serve a summons on a witness, though for 5 long months in hot weather he was kept heavily chained in a cell 4 by 8 feet in dimensions, though he received 5 dreadful stabs aimed at his heart by a bribed assassin, nevertheless he still rejoices in the motives which prompted him to undo the heavy burdens and let the oppressed go free. Having resided nearly all his life in the South, where he had travelled and seen much of the peculiar institution, and had witnessed the most horrid enormities inflicted upon the slave, whose cries were ever ringing in his ears, and for whom he had the warmest sympathy, Mr. Smith could not refrain from believing that the black man, as well as the white, had God-given rights. Consequently, he was not accustomed to shed tears when a poor creature escaped from his kind master, nor was he willing to turn a deaf ear to his appeals and groans when he knew he was thirsting for freedom. From 1828 up to the day he was incarcerated, many had sought his aid and counsel, nor had they sought in vain. In various places he operated with success. In Richmond, however, it seemed expedient to invent a new plan for certain emergencies. Hence the box and express plan was devised at the instance of a few heroic slaves who had manifested their willingness to die in a box on the road to liberty rather than continue long under the yoke. But these heroes fell into the power of their enemies. Mr. Smith had not long been in the penitentiary before he had fully gained the esteem and confidence of the superintendent and other officers. Finding him to be humane and generous-hearted, showing kindness toward all, especially in buying bread, etc., for the starving prisoners, and by a timely note of warning, which had saved the life of one of the keepers, for whose destruction a bold plot had been arranged, the officers felt disposed to show him such favours as the law would allow, but their good intentions were soon frustrated. The Inquisition, commonly called the legislature, being in session in Richmond, hearing that the superintendent had been speaking well of Smith and circulating a petition for his pardon, indignantly demanded to know if the rumour was well founded. 2 weeks were spent by the Inquisition, and many witnesses were placed upon oath to solemnly testify in the matter. One of the keepers swore that his life had been saved by Smith. Colonel Morgan, the superintendent, frequently testified in writing and verbally to Smith's good deportment, acknowledging that he had circulated petitions, etc., and took the position that he sincerely believed that it would be to the interest of the institution to pardon him, calling the attention of the Inquisition at the same time to the fact that not unfrequently pardons had been granted to criminals under sentence of death for the most cold-blooded murder, to say nothing of other gross crimes. The effort for pardon was soon abandoned for the following reason given by the governor: "I can't and I won't pardon him." In view of the unparalleled injustice which Mr. S. had suffered, as well as on account of the aid he had rendered to the slaves, on his arrival in this city, the colored citizens of Philadelphia felt that he was entitled to sympathy and aid, and straightway invited him to remain a few days, until arrangements could be made for a mass meeting to receive him. Accordingly, on last Monday evening, a mass meeting convened in the Israel Church, and the Reverend William D. Cato was called to the chair, and William Still was appointed secretary. The chairman briefly stated the object of the meeting. Having lived in the South, he claimed to know something of the workings of the oppressive system of slavery generally, and declared that, notwithstanding the many exposures of the evil which came under his own observation, the most vivid descriptions fell far short of the realities his own eyes had witnessed. He then introduced Mr. Smith, who arose and in a plain manner briefly told his story, assuring the audience that he had always hated slavery, and had taken great pleasure in helping many out of it, and though he had suffered much physically and pecuniarily for the cause's sake, yet he murmured not, but rejoiced in what he had done. After taking his seat, addresses were made by the Reverend S. Smith, Messrs. Kinnard, Brunner, Bradway, and others. The following preamble and resolutions were adopted: "Whereas we, the colored citizens of Philadelphia, have among us Samuel A. Smith, who was incarcerated over 7 years in the Richmond Penitentiary for doing an act that was honorable to his feelings and his sense of justice and humanity. Therefore, resolved, that we welcome him to this city as a martyr to the cause of freedom. Resolved, that we heartily tender him our gratitude for the good he has done to our suffering race. Resolved, that we sympathize with him in his losses and sufferings in the cause of the poor, downtrodden slave. W.S. During his stay in Philadelphia, on this occasion, he stopped for about a fortnight with the writer, and it was most gratifying to learn from him that he was no new worker on the UGRR, but that he had long hated slavery thoroughly, and always surrounded with perils on every side, he had not failed to help a poor slave whenever the opportunity was presented. Pecuniary aid, to some extent, was rendered him in this city, for which he was grateful, and after being united in marriage by William H. Furness, D.D., to a lady who had remained faithful to him through all his sore trials and sufferings, he took his departure for Western New York, with a good conscience and an unshaken faith in the belief that in aiding his fellow man to freedom, he had but simply obeyed the word of him who taught man to do unto others as he would be done by. Source: William Still, The Underground Railroad, A Record of Facts, Authentic Narratives, Letters, etc., Narrating the Hardships, Hairbreadth Escapes and Death Struggles of the Slaves in Their Efforts for Freedom, as related by themselves and others, or witnessed by the author, together with sketches of some of the largest stockholders and most liberal aiders and advisers of the road. Philadelphia, Porter and Coates, 1872. James Hambleton Christian, ex-President Tyler's household, loses an aristocratic article. James Hambleton Christian is a remarkable specimen of the well-fed, etc. In talking with him relative to his life as a slave, he said very promptly, "I have always been treated well. If I only have half as good times in the North as I have had in the South, I shall be perfectly satisfied. Any time I desired spending money, $5 or $10 were no object." At times, James had borrowed of his master $100, $200, and $300 to loan out to some of his friends. With regard to apparel and jewelry, he had worn the best, as an everyday adornment. With regard to food also, he had fared as well as heart could wish, with abundance of leisure time at his command. His deportment was certainly very refined and gentlemanly, About 50% of Anglo-Saxon blood was visible in his features and his hair, which gave him no inconsiderable claim to sympathy and care. He had been to William and Mary's College in his younger days to wait on young Master B.C., where, through the kindness of some of the students, he had picked up a trifling amount of book learning. To be brief, this man was born the slave of old Major Christian on the Glen Plantation, Charles City County, Virginia. The Christians were wealthy and owned many slaves, and belonged in reality to the first families of Virginia. On the death of the old Major, James fell into the hands of his son, Judge Christian, who was executor to his father's estate. Subsequently, he fell into the hands of one of the judge's sisters, Mrs. John Tyler, wife of ex-President Tyler, and then he became a member of the president's domestic household, was at the White House, under the president from 1841 to 1845. Though but very young at that time, James was only fit for training in the arts, science, and mystery of waiting, in which profession much pains were taken to qualify him completely for his calling. After a lapse of time, his mistress died. According to her request, after this event, James and his old mother were handed over to the nephew, William H. Christian, Esquire, a merchant of Richmond. From this gentleman, James had the folly to flee, passing hurriedly over interesting details received from him respecting his remarkable history. Two or three more incidents, too good to omit, must suffice. "How did you like Mr. Tyler?" said an inquisitive member of the Vigilance Committee. "I didn't like Mr. Tyler much," was the reply. "Why?" again inquired the member of the committee. "Because Mr. Tyler was a poor man. I never did like poor people. I didn't like his marrying into our family, who were considered very far Tyler's superiors. On the plantation," he said, "Tyler was a very cross man and treated the servants very cruelly, but the house servants were treated much better, owing to their having belonged to his wife, who protected them from persecution, as they had been favourite servants in her father's family. James estimated that Tyler got about $35,000 and 29 slaves, young and old, by his wife. What prompted James to leave such pleasant quarters? It was this. He had become enamoured of a young and respectable free girl in Richmond, with whom he could not be united in marriage solely because he was a slave and did not own himself. The frequent sad separations of such married couples, where one or the other was a slave, could not be overlooked. Consequently, the poor fellow concluded that he would stand a better chance of gaining his object in Canada than by remaining in Virginia. So he began to feel that he might himself be sold some day, and thus the resolution came home to him very forcibly to make tracks for Canada." In speaking of the good treatment he had always met with, a member of the committee remarked, "You must be akin to someone of your master's family," to which he replied, "I am Christian's son." Unquestionably, this passenger was one of that happy class so commonly referred to by apologists for the patriarchal institution. The committee, feeling a deep interest in his story and desiring great success to him in his underground efforts to get rid of slavery and at the same time possess himself of his affianced, made him heartily welcome, feeling assured that the struggles and hardships he had submitted to in escaping, as well as the luxuries he was leaving behind, were nothing to be compared with the blessings of liberty and a free wife in Canada. Theophilus Collins, Arrival from Delaware, 1858, A Desperate Bloody Struggle, Gun, Knife and Fire Shovel, Used by an Infuriated Master. Judged from their outward appearance, as well as from the fact that they were from the neighbouring state of Delaware, no extraordinary revelations were looked for from the above-named party. It was found, however, that one of their number, at least, had a sad tale of outrage.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.